Many engineering organizations are still running their own self-hosted CI/CD platform using Jenkins. Jenkins is kind of like an old car. It's comfortable and serves you well, but it's getting harder to maintain. Maintaining separate on-prem, SCM, and CI/CD products used to make sense, but tightly integrated SaaS offerings like Bitbucket Cloud have greatly improved. They have low barriers to entry, low maintenance costs, and they improve the developer experience of the teams using them. So ask yourself, why are you still running your own CI/CD platform? In this video, we're going to cover the idea of developer experience, two important stats from the Atlassian State of DevX report from 2025, the work required to set up a basic CI/CD system with Jenkins, some features of Bitbucket pipelines that help improve the developer experience, and finally, I'll talk about two ways Atlassian can help you migrate to Bitbucket pipelines from Jenkins. First, let's talk about developer experience and why it's so important. So, just a reminder for anyone who isn't familiar with developer experience is how devs think and feel about the tools, frameworks, and processes they use to deliver software within a company. There's even a Nuth quote about it. Nuth says, "The enjoyment of one's tools is an essential ingredient of successful work." A simple way of thinking about this is that developers spend more time building software and solving problems for their customers when there is low friction in their development process. Now, related to DevX, Atlassian produces a State of the DevX report every year. We interview thousands of developers and development leaders and ask questions about their team's development experiences. I want to focus on two stats from the 2025 report. First, 50% of developers now report losing more than 10 hours of their working week due to inefficiencies. This stat is wild to me. If a developer works a 50-hour work week, that means that 20% of their time is lost to friction in the development process. Second, developers are only spending 60% of their time every week writing code. This means that developers spend 84% of their time searching for information, context switching between tools, in meetings, and fighting with tech debt. If we could find ways to improve these two stats, we'd be able to spend more time building software and solving problems for our customers. Please keep these two stats in mind as we continue. Now, many of you use Jenkins alongside Bitbucket. You have a Bitbucket instance for SCM and pull requests and a Jenkins instance for CI/CD. To better understand the work involved in using Jenkins as CI/CD for Bitbucket, I built a Jenkins instance on EC2 and integrated it with my Bitbucket Cloud instance. Here's some of the work I had to do. First, I created an AWS EC2 box in CI Central 1. Then I started working through the setup and install process, which is pretty well documented and fairly simple for single node. The image above shows some of what went into setting that up. When I was done, I had a single server running Jenkins, but it didn't have resiliency, high availability, load balancing, automatic scaling, or any of the other features I'd want for a production system my team relies on. I also wasn't sure how secure everything was. I know that my setup has a ton of tech debt that I'd have to address if I wanted to keep using it. Once Jenkins was up and running, I had to install plugins for Git, Docker, and Bitbucket. This can be done through the UI, and as seen in the video clip, there are a ton of other plugins available in Jenkins. Luckily, none of the plugins I installed required extensive configuration. It was only a matter of figuring out that I needed them in the first place, but that required me to spend some time searching through a bunch of Jenkins documentation. I wanted my builds to run automatically under various conditions, such as when I pushed through a branch, cut a pull request, or merged a pull request to my production branch. Therefore, I had to set up an integration between my Bitbucket Cloud instance and my Jenkins instance. I spent some time tracking down the documentation for this, and then made the necessary changes in Bitbucket to post to a Jenkins endpoint whenever the events I cared about occurred. At this point, I had two separate pieces of software running and an integration between them I needed to set up and maintain. I'm not worried about maintaining Bitbucket Cloud since it's a SaaS product maintained by Atlassian. However, the Jenkins CI/CD system is running on my hardware, so I'll have to patch it, monitor it, upgrade it, and handle outages. I might be able to get someone else on my team to do this for me, but at the end of the day, someone is going to get paid to maintain the Jenkins system. After I had the plugins installed, I had to set up some kind of a pipeline for my test repository. There are a few ways Jenkins CI/CD can be configured. I wanted to control my CI/CD using a config file in my repository rather than purely based on configuration in the user interface, so I set up a declarative pipeline. This took some clicking around the UI and some hunting through Jenkins documentation, but it was pretty straightforward. In the previous slide, I mentioned that I wanted to be able to control my CI/CD using a config file in my repository. While Bitbucket and other vendors use YAML for their CI/CD configuration, Jenkins uses Groovy. This means that I have to learn a completely separate language just to use Jenkins, in addition to learning to write the Jenkins file syntax. I don't know Groovy, and I don't want to pick up yet another language just to use one specific tool. Luckily, I had Rovo Dev CLI to help me write the Jenkins file. Rovo is Atlassian's platform-wide AI solution, RovoDev CLI is a terminal-based way of interacting with the Atlassian platform, provides all the expected coding support that other AI tools provide, and lets me interact with my Atlassian products. After I got it to build my Jenkins file for me, I told it to update the Jira issue I was using to track my work. This is pretty handy as it saves me from having to jump into Jira, searching for the Jira issue, and manually typing the updates. This improves my DevEx because I spend less time clicking around a UI in my browser and more time in my DevTools. Now I want to talk about a couple of bits of work that came up as part of the process of standing up this Jenkins box that were unexpected. First, my new EC2 box wasn't standards compliant. Atlassian Cloud Engineering maintains standards for infrastructure running in AWS. I got 3 tickets from Cloud Engineering about things they needed to patch, update, and install on my EC2 box to make it compliant with Atlassian standards. The wiki pages describing the required steps for each of the tickets was substantial. The work wasn't hard to complete, but it pulled me away from building software and solving problems for my customers. I was spending time administrating Jenkins. Every company I've worked for has had their own standards for how to set up and configure infrastructure, so this wasn't an Atlassian-specific problem. Second, I was running a single server with Jenkins on it. This setup isn't highly available or resilient to outages and misconfigurations. I need to set up a more robust architecture if I wanted to roll Jenkins out to my team and other teams so they could use it in a production capacity. This would mean more boxes, auto-scaling, load balancers, storage, backups, and much more. This would take even more time away from building software and solving problems for my customers. I have essentially created tech debt for myself. Let's briefly touch on costs. Setting up and maintaining cloud infrastructure and software requires an engineering time, which is not free. You have to pay the engineers who do this work. There's also an opportunity cost to having engineers maintain cloud infrastructure and software rather than building software and solving problems for their customers. Internally, Atlassian has seen significant savings by using the features provided by Bitbucket Pipelines. The quoted $1.5 million annual savings were achieved using a Bitbucket feature called Dynamic Pipelines, which I'll discuss shortly. We've also seen estimates that team CI/CD costs are reduced to around 1/3 when they switch to Bitbucket Pipelines from self-hosted CI/CD systems. The savings come from a combination of factors, largely centered around not needing to pay engineers to build and maintain on-prem solutions. Now, I want to switch gears a little bit and talk about a few of the Bitbucket Pipeline features that I find improve my developer experience. For those that haven't heard of it before, Bitbucket Pipelines is Bitbucket's cloud-native CI/CD solution. It's available out of the box with no additional licensing, setup, or configuration. You can use it in any Bitbucket cloud repository by checking a single box and adding a bitbucketpipeline.yaml file to your repository. The first feature I want to talk about is Dynamic Pipelines. Dynamic Pipelines are a way for engineering teams or platform engineering teams to create and share standards-compliant pipelines across an organization. A dynamic pipeline is defined as code and can be as simple as injecting a single step into a pipeline or as complex as defining all steps and pipelines for all repositories in a workspace. There are benefits to this capability. For example, you can guarantee that a set of static analysis steps and security scanning steps are executed in every pipeline. You can eliminate duplication of steps across multiple bitbucketpipeline.yaml files. Each individual bitbucketpipeline.yaml file doesn't need to define and invoke the static analysis steps. This means fewer total lines of code to maintain and less time spent on CI/CD maintenance. It also improves the developer experience because, as a developer, I don't need to implement each of the static analysis steps every time I want to write a bitbucketpipeline.yaml file. With dynamic pipelines, I get that functionality for free. The second feature I want to talk about is AI-assisted pipelines. AI-assisted pipelines are like having a build engineer sitting beside you at all times. Whenever a step in your pipeline breaks, you can ask the system to suggest a fix for you. It'll take a look at the step, the logs, what it was trying to do, and offer suggestions about what you can do to fix it to get the pipeline up and running again without you having to waste a pile of time digging through logs manually. Next, I want to talk about self-hosted runners. By default, every step that runs in Bitbucket pipelines executes on Atlassian hardware in the cloud. However, some customers have requirements where steps have to run on their own hardware, maybe behind their firewall, for various compliance reasons. To support this, Atlassian provides self-hosted runners. You can create a self-hosted runner, and then you can use the runs-on tag in your Bitbucket pipeline file to let the Bitbucket system know to execute this particular step on the self-hosted runner. With self-hosted runners, you can get the best of both worlds. You can run some steps in the Atlassian cloud using our hardware, and you can run critical, secure steps on your own hardware behind your firewall using the self-hosted runners. So it lets you have a nice hybrid approach. You're not stuck all in the cloud, and you're not stuck all on your own hardware. Bitbucket Pipelines helps you performance tune your pipeline with a size parameter. I don't want my pipelines to cost me any more than they have to when they run. And I don't want my pipelines to take a long time to run. With the size parameter, you can tell each step in your Bitbucket pipeline file how much CPU and memory to use. So for fast steps that are non-critical and don't take a long time, you can use the 1x size multiplier, and this is the default multiplier. So if you don't have the size parameter, this is also what gets specified. And for your really slow, heavy, compute-intensive steps, you can specify up to a 16x multiplier, which will get you 32 CPUs and 64 gigabytes of RAM to work with. So this lets you performance tune your pipeline execution to meet your team's specific needs. Finally, let's briefly talk about door metrics in Jira and Compass. Because Bitbucket Pipelines is tightly integrated with the rest of the Atlassian platform, many CI/CD metrics, like the door metrics, are available to service in both Jira and Compass automatically. These are available with no additional setup. You can access them and start using them immediately. This saves you from having to set up and configure yet another tool for your metrics. I encourage everyone who is using both Bitbucket and Jenkins to consider migrating to Bitbucket Pipelines from Jenkins to improve your developer experience and spend more time building software and solving problems for your customers and less time on server setup, configuration, and maintenance. To that end, Atlassian provides a tool to help migrate declarative Jenkins pipelines to Bitbucket by converting Jenkins files to bitbucketpipeline.yaml files. You can find information about this process by following the QR code. You can also try converting Jenkins files to bitbucketpipeline.yaml files yourself using the Rovo Dev CLI, which is currently in beta. So, in summary, DevEx is important because a good DevEx means developers spend more time building software and solving problems for their customers and less time doing other, less interesting tasks. Using Jenkins with Bitbucket can add tech debt. The time and effort spent on maintenance can be better spent elsewhere. Bitbucket Pipelines has a variety of useful features that directly improve the developer experience. And migration to Bitbucket Pipelines from Jenkins is supported by Atlassian through a migration tool and the Rovo Dev CLI. Okay, thank you for watching. Please give Bitbucket Pipelines a try for yourself.